Good morning. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. This is the day that the stone rolled away. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to the Mantua Center Christian Church. Welcome to everybody that's in the house today. Welcome everybody that's online. Wave to those folks online and just greet with your neighbor for just a moment and say hello and good morning and happy Easter. We are a community together seeking to have open minds and open hearts and open arms to live and love like Jesus. This has been a time to grow as a community, as a congregation through this Lenten season, and now we continue to grow in the name of the risen Christ. I wanted to celebrate with you a few things, announcements to be made. We are having a baptism class that's going to meet this summer. So if you're interested in baptism, whether you're an adult or whether you're a kid, we are opening that up. I want to make sure you know that. Camp Christian registrations are open. So those of you who love camp and go to camp, keep that in mind. I wanted to just celebrate and give thanks for this beautiful garden that we have up here and the worship team who set it up. So let's give the worship team a hand. And thanks to Nancy Humes in particular. You'll see up here there's lots of flowers. If a flower was given in, flowers are given in your name, you're welcome to take those home. And also we have up right here in front of me little planters that have little flags in them based on our theme, and we want those to leave with you when you go. So those will be out. We'll take one set of them over there as you leave, and there's gonna be one that will stay up here as well. So please take those and plant those at home. Hopefully the kids all got a little packet in there. You'll find some things to do. I think a little slap bracelet is in there, like things like that. So please enjoy those as well. And there's an egg hunt for the kids. So I'll remind you about that later as well. As a congregation, I wanted to celebrate a few things, the way we serve our community. We have served 50 to 100 people almost every loaves and fishes meal that comes. I think we serve 68 folks on Thursday, right, Carolyn? We serve 190 kids every weekend as part of the Kids Weekend Meals program with over 50 volunteers that contribute to that. We even raised over $20,000 at our Thanksgiving plunge to help to feed these kids throughout the year. So celebrating that. We have served dozens of families through our story time ministry that happens here every week. Our smile team, the prayer shawls, holding crosses, the clothing giveaway. As a congregation, we seek to live out the resurrection spirit every single day as part of our life together. And I probably forgot 10 or 12 things that we do. So I just want to give thanks to God on this day of all days, Easter Sunday, to celebrate that. As we begin in worship, will you pray with me? Compassionate God, together we feel the breath of your Holy Spirit bringing new life in our lives, calling us to grow in our faith, inviting all to the feast that you have prepared on this day. On this Easter morning, let our whole lives be filled by your abundance. What has lain dormant, open into bloom. What has been cold and dark, burst into light. What looks like an end, may it be seen as a new possibility. We pray all this in the name of the risen Christ. Amen. As we begin in worship, our scripture reading is from 1 Corinthians 15. Listen, listen. Listen for a word from God. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Let us stand and sing our welcoming song, Morning Has Broken.
Please remain standing and join me in the call to worship. This new day is fresh with possibility to encounter the risen Christ.
With bright eyes, let us search.
This new day is fresh with possibility to understand the risen Christ.
With compassionate hearts, let us feel.
This new day is fresh with possibility to respond to the risen Christ.
With eager devotion, let us follow.
This new day is fresh with possibility to serve the risen Christ.
With humble intention, let us act.
This new day is fresh with possibility to praise the risen Christ.
With joyful praise, let us join the feast.
Please remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today, number 216. So today is Resurrection Day, And Chad just told you how we live the resurrection life, but our building too is a resurrection church. Let me take you back in time. In 1829, 9 folks gathered in a little home. And that was a resurrection from the dogma and the man-made rules of other churches. It was a search for unity in the Christian world. They got together and they signed a paper and they started a church. In 1940, they built this building, the one you're in here right now, this room. I think I saw a church once on my travels that's very like, probably like this was in the beginning, and this was a church that was seated on stone, and there was no basement, it was empty underneath, and then you just walked up into the church. Around the turn of the century, that is the turn of the 19th century, they decided to lift this building, Resurrection, and under it put a fellowship hall. We had more people, we had needed Sunday school room, so we did that. Then in around 1952, we added some stuff back here, a kitchen. You need a kitchen if you have a fellowship hall. We continued to grow, we continued the resurrection. Then in the 90s, we built this over here, the education wing. And we continued to grow. Now, we're going to refurbish this foundation that was laid in 1900. We're going to waterproof it, but then we have other goals that we want to reach. We want to make this place more accessible. And so working on that. And when I say we, I mean us. This is our church. This is our project. This is our resurrection. We'll now bring forth our tithes, gifts, and offerings. Pray with me. Generous and ever-growing God. We thank you for the resurrection, and we seek to be your resurrection people. Guide us on that path. Amen.
And will the children come on up for the children's moment with me? Come on down. Good morning. Oh, go right ahead. Happy Easter. How are you all doing? Good. Now, I have a question for you. On this Easter Sunday, we're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus, that he died and then rose again. So what I would like you to do, can you tell me about any places that you see life in this sanctuary right now? Where do you see life? Right there? That's right. This flower? Perfect. What else? Where else do you see life? I see life right there. Where else? Me? Oh, thank you, Delaney. So what about, I'm going to show you this. What about this? Looks kind of, oh, Jesus. Getting dusty all over the place. Does this look like it's full of life? Not really. It almost looks like it's dead. I got this in the mail. It had been sitting in a plastic baggie for about 3 or 4 years like this. This is called a resurrection plant. And it, I don't know if you've ever seen The Princess Bride, but really it's only mostly dead. So what I did was, is this is called a resurrection plant because it appears that it's dry and it's not ever going to be able to come to life again. But check this out. I got two other ones, not just this one. And I put a little bit of water and a little bit of sunshine, a little bit of love, and look what it turned into. So that was after it sat in a plastic bag for 3 or 4 years with nothing on it, and just a little bit of water and a little bit of sunshine made it come green and come back to life. So Easter, the day of resurrection, when we celebrate Jesus' resurrection, it's a reminder that sometimes when things feel dry, when they feel really sad, when they feel sorrowful, where they feel almost dead, that God tells us that anything is possible, that life can still come. And so we want you to always believe that, that God, no matter what's going on inside of you, what's going on around you, that God always believes in you and loves you just as you are. Okay? Each and every one of you. Now, I also have something for you to remind you of Easter, and I wonder if y'all do this, because I would love if you did this and then you told me about it. So in this little bag here, this is a symbol of Easter, of the resurrection. Thank you. Everybody knows what this is. We got ourselves a butterfly here. And inside of, what does it look like is in there? Can you tell? Almost like a little flower? Yeah. So what's embedded in this, these are paper butterflies, and inside is embedded seeds for flowers. So if you put this in some water and then put it in a pot with some soil or put it in the ground, it's supposed to grow flowers, hoping that it will grow flowers. So I want to give these to you all to plant somewhere at home, or maybe like if you have a little pot and put some soil in it, or you can put it outside
and try to grow the flowers that are inside these seeds. This is a reminder that even from something like a seed can grow amazing things. Okay? Let's see here. Let me give those to you guys. And actually, you guys can have two if you want. That way you can try if one of them doesn't go. Here, can you help me pass these out to everybody? Laney, you can help pass those out. Everybody gets two of them. The Russo house can let you really go. Try to go for it. You have a second one? There you go. Everybody got two? Here you go, buddy. So we want you to remember this Easter truth on this day. Now, you're going to go with Mrs. Delaney. She has a very fun thing for y'all to do. And there are Easter eggs hidden in this church downstairs and outside. Did you see any as you came in? Yeah, I thought you guys might have seen them. So, and those are for y'all. And Mrs. Delaney will give you instructions on how to do that. And in your baggie that you brought in, you can put these little butterflies in there, and hopefully you can do those scratch-off butterflies as well. If you happen to do one of the scratch-off butterflies, see how they're hanging in the windows over there? I think I gave you four of those, you can hang them on plants too. So you could take those and color them, and then there's a little purple string in there, and then hang them somewhere. Maybe you go and visit a grandparent today, or whether you go to families, or you may hang it at your house. Okay? All right. Happy Easter to each and every one of you. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for Jesus, for his example to love no matter what. We thank you for the gift of the resurrection. Help us to live it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right.
And rubble, out of the smoke, out of a night of struggle, can we see a ray of hope? But we can start. a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but we can build a city of men. When your trust is all but shattered, when your faith is all but killed, you can give up bitter and battered, or you can slowly start to build. A city of angels, but finally a city of man. A city of man.
God, have blessing to the hearing of the word and music today. Thanks be to God. Thank you, John. Thank you. As we come to this time of prayer, there is a response that you are welcome to join in if you feel so led. I'll say, God of new beginnings, you say, help us choose the path that leads to resurrection. Let us pray together. God of life and love, we have journeyed through this season of Lent. We have grown together as we've studied the scriptures. We have feasted together at the Lord's table. We have served one another in our community. We have grieved together at Gethsemane and at the foot of the cross. And today we are here again celebrating the joy of Easter morning. God of new beginnings, help us choose the path that leads to resurrection. God, we, like Mary Magdalene, often fail to see the risen Christ standing right there before us, shrouded in the ordinary moments in our lives. Open our eyes, living God, to the signs of new life and hope, even in the midst of darkness. God of new beginnings, help us choose the path that leads to resurrection. Like the disciples running to the tomb, we sometimes struggle to believe the truth of your resurrection. We get swallowed by the historical abyss. Instead, grant us to see the wisdom that you give us in this story, to understand the depth of your love, the power of victory over death, that we should never give up on love. Help us to embrace the gospel with hearts full of faith and conviction. God of new beginnings, help us choose the path that leads to resurrection. We rejoice here on this Easter morning, lingering in the radiance of Christ's triumph over the tomb. We do celebrate together that the stone has been rolled away, revealing a promise that life always finds a way. May this Easter be a reminder to us within our hearts, within our spirits, within our lives, that your light can pierce any darkness, that your unending grace and abundant life you offer your children is for all. God of new beginnings, help us choose the path that leads to resurrection. As we stand here today on the threshold of a new day, fill us with a longing to grow as people of faith, to be more aware of those around us, to reach out in service and compassion and empathy, to deepen our relationship with you and our neighbor, to bear witness to your love in the world, to be your resurrection people, Lord. May this joy of Easter inspire us to live lives of courage and compassion and hope, reflecting the light of Christ in all that we do as we share justice and equity and peace. God of new beginnings, help us choose the path that leads to resurrection. God, in your mercy, hear our silent prayers of celebration and sorrow on this new day. God of light, now join us together in your spirit as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Happy Easter.
Well, we missed it. At least I missed it. It only happens once a year. And this year it happened on March 17th. No, not St. Patrick's Day. Second earliest time in history. The Washington, D.C. cherry tree blossoms. And if you heard the newscasters, any of you, they were urging folks, get out. See them now. Not only because it happened so earlier, but for another reason. This was our last chance before they cut down 150 of these cherry trees come late spring. Yes, unfortunately, the land where they were planted along the tidal basin wall has settled 5 feet. And with the rising water, that area floods twice a day with the tide, comes up over the sidewalk and floods all of those trees. So there's going to be a major construction on that wall, and the cherry trees must be sacrificed. I'd like to read a poem by Alfred Edward Huseman, Loveliest of Trees. Loveliest of trees, the cherry now is hung with bloom along the bough, and stands about the woodland ride, wearing white for Eastertide. Now of my 80 years and 10, 20 will not come again. And take from 70 springs a score, it only leaves me 50 more. And since to look at things in bloom, 50 springs are little room, about the woodlands I will go to see the cherry hung with snow. So this poem describes the beauty of nature revealing itself to us at Easter time, and how it's only available to us for a fleeting moment once a year. The author actually counts out his age and how much time he has left to witness it. He says he's 20. He expects to live to 70, so he only has 50 more times to see the cherry blossoms. And we could look at this poem as a sad reminder of how fast life passes, or we could listen to the author when he tells us in the last sentence, About the woodlands I will go to see the cherry hung with snow. He's telling us to seize the moment. Live fully and deeply. Just like the news reporters were telling us, go out now. The cherry trees blossom just once a year. And my friends, we only have communion with each other once a week. Jesus taught us to gather together, to commune with one another, and to take care of one another. So today, in the spirit of this poem, let's truly immerse ourselves into this Easter communion. Close your eyes and feel the warmth of the person next to you in the pew. Experience the energy that you gain by physically passing the emblems to one another. Slow down and imagine Jesus himself placing the bread and the wine into your hands. Smell the aroma of the cherry blossoms. We will now sing In the Garden, number 227, verses 1 through 3.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, on this joyous Easter day, we come together as a family to give thanks and praise for the incredible gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. As we celebrate his resurrection, we are reminded of the triumph of light over darkness, hope over despair, and life over death. Amen. On the night of the Passover, Jesus called his disciples together, and when they had gathered in the upper room, he took bread. He blessed it and broke it, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you." And in a like manner, he took the cup. He blessed it and poured it out, saying, "Take and drink, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of sin. For every time that you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me." Remember that all are welcome at the Lord's table.
Thank you.
And all of God's people said, amen. As the choir takes their seats, I just want to let you know that during our sermon today, you're going to be singing, too. It's going to be number 638. It's in the bulb. There's a flower. It's going to be on the wall as well. But just wanted to give you a heads up. You may have noticed that we had a garden theme this year as part of our Lenten study and part of all that we do, and we have a lot of gardeners, and there's lots of lessons to be learned. And in this story today, we learn that in the place where Jesus was laid was also a garden. So we end here our Lenten season, a new beginning on Easter. Will you bow with me in prayer as we prepare to hear the scripture? Living God, today's good news is so amazing that we struggle to wrap our heads around it. Give our hearts the wisdom to receive that which our heads can't fully understand, Lord. Make us open to receive your promise and to live it. Send your spirit to fill our whole selves with your resurrection promise. Help us to hear your word anew today and help us grow in our faith. We pray this in the name of the risen one. Amen. We read from the gospel according to John chapter 20, verses 1 to 18. Listen, listen, listen for a word from God. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scriptures that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God. Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. A burst of recognition. Last week, we offered stories from Jesus' life as part of our Palms to the Garden service. and lessons from the garden from a number of folks on our worship team. And we ended the service in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus was distressed, where he was longing for his disciples to stay with him. They were falling asleep, and soon the peace of the garden was interrupted with the sounds of marching soldiers ready to take Jesus away. One of his disciples betrayed him. One of them denied him three times that he even knew him. The cross awaited him, and Jesus was crucified. A lost stream. The cold darkness of a spiritual winter sets in. Little did those who loved him know that a seed had been planted. Let us sing the first verse together.
In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its seed. Something God alone can see.
And then on the third day, on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been rolled away. And at first, you may have noticed that this didn't bring her joy, but fear. She runs and tells the other disciples that she didn't know what has happened. They come and go with great uncertainty, and then they return in the same way with uncertainty and fear. But Mary did not retreat. She stays. Filled with courage, she goes back to the tomb and stands there, surrounded by the beauty of all that surrounds her. She stays by Jesus, even in the face of death. Yet still overcome with emotion, she weeps. She weeps for her teacher. She weeps for her friend. She weeps for a dream of what could have been that was lost. She peers into the tomb to only see the messengers of God that are there who ask her why she's weeping. For they know, I know something you don't know, they say. And then he's there, hidden in plain sight. The scripture says she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. This one that she supposes is the gardener asks her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking? For whom are you looking?" A question that we might even ask ourselves in this day, in this hour, in our lives, in our longing, in our striving, for whom or what are we really looking for? What is it that we really want out of this life? Even amidst the grief and confusion and uncertainty, she is asked this question, and can you feel that new life is stirring? What seems dormant, even dead, is beginning to pierce the cold darkness. Let us sing together.
There's a song in every silence, seeking words. Bringing hope to you and me. There will rise, will come the future. What it holds, a mystery unrevealed until its season. Something God alone can see.
After all, what is hidden can't remain hidden forever. We are all blessed here in Northeast Ohio to experience, or I don't know, blessed might be a strong word for some of us, but by the experience of the cycles of life, the cycles of the seasons. Every spring, we wait with great anticipation for the specks of green to come. And have you all started seeing them? I know I have. We watch for the tulips and the daffodils. We await the crocuses and the hostas, the butterfly weed. We trust that they will come because life always finds a way. But we do take the miracle of life for granted sometimes, don't we? Well, we notice what is hidden in plain sight, that it happens so fast sometimes we don't even notice. Yes, then, Easter Sunday is literally an invitation to, yes, literally stop and smell the roses or see the cherry blossoms or look at the trees, at the flowers, even at one another, to take in the gift of life. So really, it probably shouldn't surprise us. We may look at Mary Magdalene and said, how could you not recognize him in that moment? But of course she didn't. She's a human being just like all of us. It's not a surprise that Jesus would go unrecognized, that life would go unrecognized, that hope would go unrecognized. Most of the stories of the risen Christ, if you remember, he isn't recognized right away. Those closest to him don't even recognize him at first, and perhaps we won't either. Mary supposes him to just be the gardener. If you remember in the Gospel of Luke, the disciples on the road to Emmaus just suppose him to be a passerby. The disciples walking by the Sea of Galilee in the Gospel supposed he was a fisherman. Today we may suppose him to be the cashier or the waiter. We may suppose him to be a migrant or a refugee. We may suppose him to be a teacher or a nurse or a professor or our boss. We may even suppose him to be the stranger sitting next to us in these really tight pews this morning. We may suppose him to be a child or even our enemy. We may suppose him to be the wind, a blooming flower, or a sunrise. We may suppose him to just be our neighbor that we see day in and day out, unrevealed until its season. The risen Christ in disguise all along. Mary has her burst of recognition when Jesus calls out her name. It is the moment that the flower blooms, the fruit ripens, the feast is prepared, that hope is alive, that new life is realized. And then we see that however long that she wants to stand there and take it all in, Jesus tells her, "Do not hold on to me." She wants to freeze that moment in time, to perpetually taste and see that it is good, but it turns out we cannot hold on to the risen Christ for too long, for the risen Christ is on the move. There is life to be made all over, and we are called to join him in that. It is powerful here because we witness that because Mary stays, because Mary is with him, because Mary stays long enough to recognize him, Mary becomes the very first minister of the gospel. She didn't even have to go to seminary or anything. She just went. She is the one that brings a message of liberation and grace and hope to the disciples who felt like all of that was lost. So we share in her legacy today of sharing the gospel, to welcome all to the feast, to share what we have known, what we have seen, what we have tasted, what we have witnessed, to proclaim with our very lives that death doesn't have the final word, that life will always find a way, that we don't give up on each other or on goodness or even on ourselves. That we believe with the Apostle Paul, who wrote that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything in all of the creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God for that gift. That Christ bids us all come to the feast for which we wait, that in ends are always new beginnings. Let us sing together.
In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity, in our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity, in our death
Family of God, may we keep an eye out then for the risen Christ, who may be in disguise right in front of you, to recognize his appearance in one another and the gift of the creation around us. May we follow in the footsteps of Mary and share the good news. And may the risen Christ live in our kindness, our generosity, our compassion, our love, to one another, to our community, and to all of the human family. May it be so. Amen. Amen. Church family, will you please now stand with me and join in singing our closing hymn, Thine is the Glory. Let us sing. Thank you. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let us bow for the benediction. Together we have celebrated a feast of abundance. We have heard the good news and rejoice in God's saving grace, and we mustn't linger in the garden for long, but set out to invite all to the table. As Christ burst forth from the womb, from the tomb, may new life burst forth from us, revealed in acts of love and healing to a hurting world. And may the same Christ who lives forever and is the source of our new life keep our hearts rejoicing and grant us peace this day and always. Amen. Amen. Repeat after me, Christ has died.
Christ has died.
Christ has risen.
Christ has risen.
Christ will come again.
Christ will come again.
Christ has died.
Christ has died.
Christ has risen.
Christ has risen.
Christ will come again.
Christ will come again.
And Christ will come again and again and again and again and again in every act of kindness, in every act of love, in every act of hope. May we live that resurrection spirit now and always. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Don't forget to take some plants.